I have completed my 1993 model year Chevrolet truck brochure collection. This is the 1993 Chevy, commercial Chevy's brochure. Got it on eBay just like the other three. Now I have pickups, SUVs, and vans. And this one actually has a lot of the vehicles listed in here. It just shows basically the stripped down like cargo van versions. It doesn't have any like the options listings. And I've read this already. I picked it up at my friend's house because I still don't have an eBay account. I gave him the money and he bought it on eBay. But it, anyway, as I was saying, I read this at my friend's house, but I don't remember. I didn't read what when this thing was published. July 1992, so it's an early one. That's like when the 93 model year vehicles were first coming out. It has the same passage in the front page like my other three brochures. Look how old that computer is. Glare from the damn light. My mom accidentally dialed me when she got off the phone with my dad. That's what that was about. Anyway. All the usual information. Apparently the Scotch Guard was a wasn't a new option in the S10 pickup in S10. Nice little spread of a bunch of trucks. It's like a 68 or a 69, maybe a 70 C series right there. Early 80s. And that's a new 93 C2500. Yeah, as you can see, it shows you all the stuff for the pickup. I like the regular cab dualies. And the S10. Now, no matter what S10 pickup you ordered back in 93, back in the early 90s, the Vortec 4.3 liter was the obvious superior choice. 165 horsepower at 4,000 RPM and 235 pounds-feet of torque at 2,400 RPM. I mean, look how underpowered those other two engines were. The 2.5 liter Iron Duke 4-cylinder with 105 horsepower at 4,800 RPM. 4,800 RPM, that's not too bad, I guess. But 105 horsepower and 135 foot-pounds of torque, or pounds-feet of torque, at 3,200 RPM. And the 2.8 liter V6. With EFI, 125 horsepower at 4,800 RPM and 150 pounds-feet of torque at 2,400 RPM. Though as underpowered as it is, as underpowered as the Iron Duke is, that is actually right on par with the competition. I don't think the Toyota 22RE or whatever it was called had much more than that. The little Toyota 4-cylinders. And I don't know about Nissan. And I actually think Ford's 4-cylinder engine and the Ranger only made about 100 horsepower, maybe a little less. And I think the Dodge Dakota's 4-cylinder was a little bit less than that. And what else? Don't know about the Dodge D50 and Mitsubishi Mighty Max, but as underpowered as that is, that's right on par with the competition at the time. And let's skip to the very end for a minute. Where's the pickup section? Back to the beginning. According to this, the axle ratios available in the S10 are the 273, the 308, the 342, the 373, and the 411. Now, I believe the 308 and the 342 are the two you can get with the 4.3 liter V6. That's what it says at the end for the towing, recommended towing combinations here, though. According to this, in both the automatic and manual transmission, S10's equipped with the 2.5 liter fuel-injected inline 4. You can get a 373 or a 411 gear ratio. That must improve in acceleration greatly, though. I can't imagine by much, but and this isn't just the gross vehicle weight rating. This is the towing capacity. GC, what the hell is GC? Oh wait, this is the gross combination weight rating. My bad. This isn't the total towing capacity. But yeah, you can only get the 373 with the Vortec V 4.3 liter in the full-size trucks and vans. Now, what I'm wondering is if you could get the 2.8 or the 2.5 with the posi traction rear. That would improve acceleration and towing greatly. And I don't see the 273 in here anywhere. Holy crap, you can get it in some of the vehicles, you can get it with up to a 456 gear ratio. And then some of the really big commercial trucks have a 513 gear ratio. Matched up with a 454, that thing could tear down a house. back to the S series. But yeah, I think the 4.3 is the way to go. And there's an error right there. That license plate has 8 digits in it. National maximum typically is like 7. Actually, it is 7. In Pennsylvania, it's 7. Most other states, it's 7. Yeah, it's 7. That's just a stripped down interior. I don't even think that one has air conditioning. And in a little truck like that, I can see why some people might order it without air. Now these are the really nice trucks, the CK series right here. Now, for some reason, in the thought it was higher for a sec, but no, it's the same as in the specs in the Chevy trucks brochure. 165 horsepower and 235 foot-pounds of torque seems a little small for a full-size pickup, but I mean, I remember seeing some sort of Motor Week test on YouTube of the 1988 Chevy Cheyenne with a 4.3 liter, and that made 160 horsepower, which is less than this, and that had pretty good pickup, I remember them saying. 34 gallon gas tank, holy shit, that's a lot. Now, why the hell wouldn't the diesel be available in the 1500 in Cali? And also, that's another thing. In the Chevy trucks brochure, it says that you can't get the swing-out rear windows in the Cheyenne. And why you'd get an extended cab with only 2 seats, I have no idea. Unless you planned on putting subwoofers in the rear area, I don't see any point in getting a extended cab with only the front seats. Or if you just plan to haul tools back there all the time. And I forget when they started applying the Vortec name to the V8s. I think that was like 95 or 96. That's not a bad looking truck right there. That dually. That is the Cheyenne model, but it's still a sharp looking truck. And strangely enough, the HD version of the 454 and the 350 both have somewhat less horsepower than the ones in the 1500s. Like, you get the 454 SS with 255 and horsepower and 255 horsepower and 405 pounds-feet of torque. This is a little bit less, and the same with the 350. The 350 loses 20 horsepower, It has the same amount of torque, but it loses 20 horsepower. It says heavy-duty emissions or something. Of course, the 454 SS was tuned for outright performance. And yeah, it says standard and 454 SS model only for the 1500, and it doesn't give the upgraded performance specs in here either. It just shows the standard 454. Looks like an old Monte Carlo in the back of that. It calls it a retriever body. I just call it like a rollback truck or a flatbed. And that's called Chevy 2000. That's apparently like a factory utility body. Chevy 2000, never heard of it. Yeah, this is all pretty much what's covered in there. And what I would have liked to do was get an Astro cargo van, but get it with all the features of the CS or the LT trim, and have like a custom van right from the factory. But what sucks is with both the Lumina APV is the same way. Whereas the passenger version, you can get a more powerful engine. This only comes with a base engine. With the Astro still has respectable power. It still has a 4.3 liter V6. You can't get this central port injection V6, but you still get 165 horsepower and 235 pounds-feet of torque, and you can still tow like 5,000 pounds or more. And it doesn't come with all-wheel drive. I guess that didn't become an option in cargo an Astro cargo vans until like later in the 90s. But you could get it with a 323, 342, or 373 rear axle ratio, and this variant of the Astro is apparently available with a locking rear. There was no mention of a locking rear in the regular van, passenger vans brochure. And apparently ABS is standard on all these. And it's got the full-size Blazer, the Suburban, the S Blazer. All that. But yeah, while the Astro still has respectable power, the Lumina has this wimpy little engine. The passenger one you could get with a 3.8 liter V6 as an option. That's a damn good engine. And it was more powerful than any other minivan in its on the market at the time. It had 175 horsepower and 225 foot-pounds of torque. But this one you only get the 120 horse. I mean, it is not a bad looking vehicle, but I'd want the 3800, the 3.8. And I think there was like some sort of partnership between GM and Toyota at some point. And both the Cavalier and the Lumina minivan share a lot of interior design cues with an 1987 to 91 Toyota Camry. My mom had one. The interior with the air conditioning vents and all that looked very similar. Though it was probably built a little bit better given the build quality of American cars in the 90s versus Japanese. It looks like a dustbuster on wheels. And the Astro van. My family owned a GMC Safari once. The only complaint we had about it was the air conditioning didn't seem to ever work right. Other than that, it was a great vehicle, very reliable, very easy to drive, very comfortable. It was a conversion van, but the air conditioning always leaked and we had to get it recharged. And even when it was charged with R134A, it never seemed to blow as cold as it should. Although that one time driving through the southern part of Washington State, the AC definitely worked good. And when it went over 100 degrees in Virginia that one time, it worked really good. But the AC never worked as good as the Air in the Odyssey or any other car we've had. But it was still a good van. Yeah, there's the performance specs. Locking rear diff. I would love to get one of these with those nice alloy wheels. Like those. But on there. And power everything. You could probably get it with power everything. And the sport van. Love the sport van. Or in this case, it's just called the Chevy van.
This has been a Stamped Octagon production.